I want to talk to you tonight about rejection. How to defeat and how to conquer rejection. And it's a very personal preaching because that was me. When I was little, I grew up in this school, which my father was in business. It was a school for wealthy people. And in that school, I was little. I was in kindergarten, and it was a religious school, but there was so much competition, like who had this and who had the biggest house and the latest car. And I grew up in a culture to compete, to try to belong, and it never worked. It never worked. If you try to please men, you will never win. It is impossible to please men. So we must learn to be free from rejection. Now, let's go to the scripture in the book of John, chapter 1, verse 9. I love to talk about Jesus. And I'm going to ask you tonight to open your heart to the Word of God. You know, the Word of God is powerful. If you open your heart to it, your life will be transformed. There is power in the scripture. There is power in the Word of God. And look what it says in John 1, verse 9. There it was. The true light was then coming into the world, the genuine, perfect, steadfast light that illuminates every person. It came into the world, and though the world was made through him, we're talking about Jesus, the world did not recognize him, did not know him. He came to that which belonged to him, his own, his domain, his creation, his things, his world. And they who were his own did not receive him and did not welcome him. Since day one, Jesus, the Creator, God made flesh. He came with unconditional love. He faced rejection every single day. You will too. Rejection will always surround us. Well, but we must learn not to let it inside of us. We can learn to control it. We can learn to defeat it. And we must do it. You will first face rejection, like I did and like I still do. We are in a fallen world. And the truth is that this world, because of sin, was rejected. So we are born into the system in which rejection is the number one thing. I mean, the king of this world, which is the enemy, will reject anything that has to be with God or anything that is good or anything that has the potential to change the system in which he is the king. And that's why you have faced rejection. You have not faced rejection because you're ugly, because you're fat, because you're a woman, because you're a man, or because you're Hispanic, or because you're white, or because you're black. You have faced rejection because there's something in you that is powerful, and the ruler of this world is afraid of you. You will have faced rejection because you're important. And I want to define what is rejection. And I found a scripture that tells it all. It's in the book of Proverbs 29, verse 25. And I'm reading from the Amplified Bible because we don't have the Amplified Bible in Spanish. And that's my favorite Bible. So every time I preach in English, I use it. The fear of man brings a snare. But whoever leans on, listen to this, trust in, and put his confidence in the Lord is safe and set on high. Many crave and seek the ruler's favor, but the wise man waits for justice from the Lord. An unjust man is an abomination to the righteous, and he who is upright in the way of the Lord is an abomination to the wicked. What is rejection? Rejection is when you fear other people's opinion about you. It's when you value at heart their words, their attitudes, their actions towards you in a way that it will control you, or in a way that at least will limit your freedom to be yourself. Rejection is based on fear. It's based on insecurity. It's seeking others' approval. It's seeking men's acceptance in order to feel good about yourself. And so we must learn to overcome it. Our value, our identity, and our freedom is in Jesus. It's not in anybody else. Rejection is a mind game. And it will lead us to spiritual oppression. You see, there's such a thing called the spirit world. And in there you find demons, you find entities that are wicked, that will come to bring fear, that will come to bring condemnation, that will come to bring judgment, for you to feel small, for you not to feel the value. You see, there's such things as the demon of religion. Let me tell you something, religion is full of rejection. It's because of the demonic of rejection that religion is. And religion is a man's ways to try to project himself to God. You don't need to do nothing. Jesus died for you. He did it all. He did it all. All you have to do is make a decision for Jesus. That's all you have to do. My experience with rejection has been amazing. I come from Cuba. By the way, I was supposed to show a video and I forgot. I come from Cuba, and it's a very idolatry culture. It's a lot of religion culture, and the message that I found all my life at home and in school is that whatever you do, you make sure you do something right, because if not, God will punish you. If you don't do it right, God will reject you. When I was growing up, I loved sports, and I was rejected on all the tryouts. Then I loved music. I was rejected in all the record companies. And rejection has been around me all the time. That's what I told you, that it was a personal message. So when I came to the Lord, I found my way out of rejection, because he's the only way out of rejection. Only Jesus, only the cross of Jesus can set you free from fear, from condemnation, and from judgment. So I ask you tonight, what is your experience with rejection? What is your experience? Was it a father that was at home? You know, my father was a very good father, amazing father, and I love my father, and I'm very proud of my father. He passed away like 12 years ago. But he was a workaholic. He was never home. He was working and working and working, because when he left Cuba, he lost everything. And then he had that fear that he didn't want to lose everything again. So he was working, and a lot of time he was not home. Finally, I made it to one team, and he never came to see me play. And something inside of me said, why? I don't feel loved by him. He doesn't care about me. And it was all a lie from the enemy. His love for me was amazing. He was a great father. It's just that we all have things, you know. We are not perfect. We all have different issues. And what is your experience with rejection? Is it a divorce? Did someone promise you to love you forever and then he left you? Or then she left you? Is it bankruptcy? Did you go to a hard season in your finances and insecurity came and you felt alone and you felt criticized? What is your experience with rejection? Is it a church? Did you go to a church and they start talking about you? They said that you were weird or they were different? I know that doesn't happen here and doesn't happen in California, but believe me, in a Hispanic church, that happens a lot. Maybe it was a toxic relationship, that it was always criticizing you. Maybe it was a teacher in school. Maybe it was a coach that they always saw the negative in you and they never saw the good things that you had? What is your experience with rejection? Because I'm sure that you have a few. And I'm telling you, it's not the end of it. We need to learn how to overcome rejection. We must learn to walk in authority. We must learn to protect our feelings, our heart. What is your experience with rejection? Was there a boyfriend that told you that you were fat? Let me tell you something, and I will speak with respect. If you're with someone right now, that is your boyfriend or your girlfriend, and it's criticizing you, it's telling you that you're not good, it's telling you that you're ugly, it's telling you that they don't like your hair, it's telling you that they don't like what you do, get rid of them. You deserve better. And God has someone for you that they will appreciate who you are, that they will love you just like the love of Jesus, that he loved you the way you are, and he received you the way you are. You don't need a boyfriend. You don't need a girlfriend that says, I don't like your God. I don't like you serving Jesus. I don't like you going to church. Get rid of it. Get rid of it. Get rid of it. There's someone better. Trust the Lord for your future husband. Trust the Lord for your future wife. He will never make a mistake. And that person will come into your life to value you, to exhort you. And doesn't matter how much you wait. Doesn't matter the color of your hair. Let me tell you something, ladies. There's any lady in the house? Men like all type of shapes and forms. You don't have to be a Barbie to attract a good man. Men like all type of shapes of form. Just the way you are is perfect for the guy that has for you, God has for you. Celebrate who you are. Embrace who you are. Say, thank you, Jesus, because I have this big and I have this little. Praise the Lord Jesus. I'm going to teach you tonight how to get rid of rejection. Tonight you're going to be set free from fear. Tonight condemnation is going to be destroyed in the name and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Are you ready? I wish you can take notes. Number one. And this is the most important one. Embrace in your heart the revelation of Jesus Christ as the most important treasure in your life. I repeat it again because this is awesome. Embrace in your heart, the revelation of Jesus. God made flesh. He took the leadership and he came into this world who reject him. He came for you to save you, to heal you, to bless you, to love you, and to let you know who you really are. I found myself who I was when I embraced in my heart the revelation of Jesus. There's a scripture in the book of Romans, chapter 8, verse 31. Listen to this. This is so powerful. What then shall we say to all this? If God is for us, who can be against us? Who can be our foe if God is on our side? He who did not withhold or spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not also with him freely and graciously give us all other things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? Listen, God's elect. You are elected by God. That means that you are not rejected by God. I love this. Who shall bring any charge? Who shall bring any condemnation? Who shall bring any judgment? Who shall bring any rejection against God's elect? Who it is? God who justifies, that is, who puts us in right relationship to himself, who shall come forward and accuse or impeach those who God has chosen. God elect us. We are chosen by him. Will God, who acquaint us, who is there to condemn us, will Christ Jesus, the Messiah, who died, or rather who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, actually pleading as he intercedes for us? Can you embrace this word? Can you embrace that you are God's elect? Can you embrace that you're God's chosen? You are the church of God. Christianity is the church of God. There's no other church of God but Christianity. You are the church of God. You are the child of God. You and me, we were created in his image. There is a purpose in your life. We are never alone. He has promised to be with us always. Even in your mistakes, you will find the God that loves you unconditional. Even in your worst days, in your big mistakes, you will find his grace. You will find his forgiveness. You will find his acceptance. We have a Father that will never leave you. We have a Father that cares so much that he has promised in his word to be with you in the good, in the bad, and in the ugly. We are the church of Jesus. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. You are the place where the Holy Spirit dwells. And he paid the highest price for you. He paid the highest price for your freedom. He paid the highest price for your prosperity and for your eternity. And he loves you and he loves us unconditionally. Can you believe that he listens to you when you pray? The God of the universe listens to you when you pray. Can you believe that he dwells in your worship? I love the worship. I was so much into the worship and into Pastor Dan giving the announcement that I forgot I was preaching tonight. I love the worship. Can you believe that he dwells when you worship him? Like when you're alone in your house and you raise your hands and you start worshiping him and declaring him love, can you believe that he comes and he dwells in your worship? He doesn't dwell anywhere else. He doesn't dwell in the heavens because the heavens are too small for him. He doesn't dwell in planet Earth. Planet Earth is too small for him. But he dwells in your worship. Your worship is big enough for him to come and dwell with you. There is a very special attention towards you. For we Christians are his family. And you are his children. Embrace the revelation of Jesus in your heart. The God that created all. And he decided to come to it all. To redeem us and to show us his love and his acceptance. Number two, receive by faith the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. The church is not an institution. The church is an organism. It's alive. The church is alive. I love this scripture in 2 Timothy, verse 1, verse 7. Chapter 1, verse 7, look what it says. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, of cowardice, or craving, or cringing, or falling fear. But he has given us a spirit of power. Of what? Power. He has given us a spirit of power, and of love, and of calm, and well-balanced mind, and discipline, and self-control. Can you tonight embrace, by faith, the empowerment of the Holy Spirit? I have learned that everything that God does it through someone. We need to collaborate with God. He will set us free, but we need to work with him for our freedom. I have learned that everything in the kingdom of God is a decision. Love is a decision. Salvation is a decision. Why do we go to heaven? Well, we go to heaven because we decide to go to heaven. We decide with the owner of heaven. We accept his conditions. We accept his message. It's our decision to accept that revelation, and then we go to heaven. Heaven is a decision. Heaven is not because you work towards heaven. Heaven is not because you're religious and you practice a religion and you go to the heaven. Heaven is when you make a decision to follow the owner of heaven, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He created heaven for you and for me, not for him. God, the Holy Spirit, wants to anoint you and empower you to be a conqueror. You got saved not just to be a Christian and just, no. You got saved to do great things. And it all starts with you and your house and your family. And the Holy Spirit can anoint you and can empower you to be a conqueror. Develop an intimate relationship with him. Every morning, welcome him into your life. Good morning, Holy Spirit. Good morning, Holy Spirit. Reveal me Jesus. Remind me of Jesus. Remind me his word. I want to know him. Invite the Holy Spirit into your life. Talk to him. Learn about him in scripture. It is so important to have a good relationship with the Holy Spirit to walk in victory. For he is the manifestation of all power from God. It's in the Holy Spirit where you find the power of God. It's in the Holy Spirit, which is in planet Earth, which is inside of you, that you find the power. The Almighty of God is manifested through the person of the Holy Spirit. That's why he gave it to us. He says here, he did not give us a spirit of timidity or cowardice. He gave us the spirit of power. You know, pray that the Holy Spirit will manifest his power in your life. Because all my life, I was worried about people's accepting me. All my life, I was worried about if my father didn't love me or I didn't make the team or the compete. I must please men all my life until one day I pray and I say, Holy Spirit, I want to be set from free. And I say, go ahead, you started and I will follow you. Go ahead, make a decision, I will anoint you. Go ahead, raise up. Start being a whiny. Stop being timid. Stop being a complainer. Go ahead and do something about it, because when you stand up and you do something about it, he will do something about it too with you. Receive by faith the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. Embrace in your heart the revelation of Jesus. For without Jesus, there's nothing we can do. Number three, manage your life with wisdom. Manage your life with wisdom. Choose the right friends. Disconnect from toxic relationships. You don't belong everywhere. There's a place for you where you will flourish. You don't have to go where the crowd go. You know, my wife loves purses and shoes. I noticed. So when she was mad at me, you know, I went and I bought a purse. And then shoes. And I learned from her this. She will buy the purse that she likes. She will not necessarily buy the purse that is shown in TV with celebrities. Or in social medias, in social media with celebrities. You know that these people wear this dress? And because she wear that dress, I want that dress. That is rejection. You buy that dress, or any dress that you like, because you want it. Not because someone else wear it. Say amen to that. Say amen to that. You be yourself. And when someone tries to make you someone that you're not, you need to manage your life with wisdom. Disconnect from toxic relationship. Disconnect from the message in the media and the message of this world that tries to control you, to define what to dress, to define what to wear, to define how to talk. You know, in the youth, in the church, one day I go to a youth service and they're talking a different language. They're talking like, what are you guys talking? I don't understand nothing you guys are saying. You're a bunch of Hispanics. You know, you're second, third generation. Okay, you're bilingual. But then come to talk to me like you're from, I don't know where, what planet you come from. Because they're listening to this music and they're watching this show and they're absorbing what these people are giving them. And I found that wrong. Because that tells me that they have rejection in their heart. They're not embracing who they are. They're embracing what others want them to be. And when you find yourself involved with people that want to influence you to be someone who you're not, you need to manage your life. Find help if you need it. And if you're married and you're in a covenant of marriage and this is going on, because I see it in my church all the time, find help. Call the office, make a pastor appointment, find help. Find a leader, find a disciple, find help, because it won't work. The marriage will always be in conflict if we don't learn to appreciate who she is or who he is. If we don't learn to value who they really are. Marriage must be freed of rejection. Because when there's rejection in a marriage, the demon of manipulation and control will come and will be there. And we don't get married to control nobody. We get married to love and to exalt and celebrate and to be ourselves. Somebody say amen to that. So if you're in a covenant relation, find help. And we need to learn how to manage our life with wisdom, because if not, we will repeat our past. Avoid repeating the past. You know, our church is a beautiful church. I love my church. And the women in my church are amazing, amazing leaders. Pastor Deborah has been there. By the way, Pastor Deborah is the number one preacher in our church. Number one. They love her. They love her. They love her. All the time we do focus groups. I don't do them, but the executive people do them, whatever. And they do a focus group to see how we're doing and to see what they like. And we did a focus group for men retreat. We do a march. We do a men retreat. And we got a lot of men to go to the retreat. And in the focus group, they asked, who would you like us to invite to preach? Guess who was number one? Pastor Deborah. I said, wait a minute. I am not going to call Pastor Deborah and her husband to ask them to come to a men's retreat. And they put up a fight. Why not? They said, because I don't feel comfortable. Why not? You preach in the women's conference. And you're a man. Why can she not come and preach to us? We like her. She's on fire, you know. She's on fire. And she confronts us with love. And we like her. What do you say about that, Pastor Jim? I said, man, these people are weird. I have a bunch of weird people. But, you know, they kind of convinced me. Why not? Why not? Why can you woman cannot come to men's conference and teach us the word of God? Why not? Why not? It's the same word. It's the same anointing. And the perspective that you guys have, that girls have, we needed to learn about that. We don't have it. Why not? Right? But the thing is that avoid repeating your past. And one right decision at a time will lead you to success. Success comes to us through a process of failure and good decisions. Failure will come. It's okay. We learn from it. And then we make the right decisions. And we will reach success. So it's very important that you manage your life with wisdom. Surround with people of faith. It's why it's important you congregate. Surround with people that love Jesus. Surround with people who are real. We're just humans and we make mistakes. Surround with the right people. Learn how to choose. Learn how to choose the right company and teach your kids about that. Teach your sons and daughters about that. Number four, walk in forgiveness. You will never be free of anything. Of anything. If you have unforgiveness in your heart. Very important. Jesus taught about this in the gospel. He says it's important that you forgive. Because if you don't walk in forgiveness like I do, my Father who's in heaven will not forgive you. And then my Father who's in heaven, if you walk in forgiveness, my Father who's in heaven will allow for you to come tormentors, which is demonic activity. So if you're here tonight and you have unforgiveness in your heart, we all go through that. We have all gone through that. But let me tell you something. Forgiveness is a decision. It's not because you feel it and you're ready. No, no, no. You will never be ready to forgive someone who hurt you. And no, I'm going to forget about it. I'm not going to think about it. I'm going to forget about it. That doesn't mean that you forgive. And the God of the Bible demands, it's a demands as a king, that we work on forgiveness. So make sure that you walk in forgiveness. It's important to forgive others. Because if you don't forgive, they will have power over you. Any situation that you don't forgive, that situation eventually will control you. And God will help you through the process of forgiveness. And God will heal your wounds. And God will set you free. But first, he must hear from you. Lord, I have decided because of you, I don't feel it. Maybe inside of me, I just want to kill him. Oh, I really don't like him. I don't want to see her ever, Lord. I don't want to see. But your word says that I have to forgive. On your word, I have made a decision to forgive him. That's all he needs. And he will establish you in the process of setting you free. To forgive is to be free. And forgiveness will keep you hurt and will keep your past alive. And unforgiveness will make you hurt others. Unforgiveness will make you reject others. And we don't want that, right? You know, offenses and rejection will always be around us. We just need to learn how not to let it come inside us. You know, you cannot control what will be around all the times, but you can always control what will be inside. Don't let it come inside. Leave it outside. Rejection doesn't belong inside of you. That's of the world. It's not of the kingdom. And I want to give you number five. Be yourself and enjoy yourself. Can you receive that? Be yourself. Enjoy yourself. You know, when I was studying to be a pastor, I had a professor. He was a good man, good pastor. But every time he put me to preach, he had a list of 100 things that I did wrong. So, oh my God. So why is God calling me to be a pastor if I don't know how to preach? You're screaming. You're screaming too much. You need to have eye contact. You need to read the scripture slowly. You need to do this. You need to do. Look how I do it. Look how I do it. And we all need mentors, and we learn from others, and we must have a heart to be teachable. But at the same time, you need to be yourself. It got to a point that I told the professor, I cannot do it like that. I cannot do it. Give me an F, but I'm going to do it my way. Oh, my God. It was like a tormented. That class was like tormenting me. And I prepare, and I took all the points. But in the time to deliver, it didn't come out that way. It came out the other way. Be yourself. Celebrate who you are. It's okay to be different. Your biggest attribute is that you're different. And value your individuality. That's your biggest asset. It's good to be different. Enjoy who you are. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. For we are God's own handiwork. I love that. Handiwork. His workmanship. That's who we are. Is everybody reading the scripture? For we are God's own handiwork. His workmanship. Recreated in Christ Jesus. Born anew. That we may do those good works for God's, for which God predestined, planned beforehand. That's what God planned for you. Good works. And it says, taking paths for which he prepared ahead of time, that we should walk in them, living the good life which he prearranged and made ready for us to live. Isn't that powerful? Enjoy being yourself. Enjoy being yourself. If you're going to change something about you, you're going to do it because you want to do it. Not because others want you to do it. You're going to do it because it's your decision. You want to do it. Enjoy being yourself. Embrace in your heart the revelation of Jesus. Walk in forgiveness. It is great to be free from unforgiveness. And receive by faith the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. He is here tonight. He is there with you. He will anoint you. He will listen to you. There is nothing that he cannot do. Therefore, there is nothing that you cannot do with him. And number 5, manage your life with wisdom. Those 5 things help me to conquer rejection, to conquer fear, and to conquer condemnation that I had in my life.